Hello, everyone. Today we're here with a very special person, Mallory. Mallory and I have just begun recently working together, and I'm super excited to show you why we have begun working together, why Mallory's position is so, so important for anyone, but definitely on a trying to conceive journey. A little bit about Mallory. Mallory is an entrepreneurial and executive coach. She specializes in things like mindset growth and subconscious reprogramming. Mallory has spent years dedicated to understanding the science of behavior, habit, performance, and healing, and has been featured in numerous media platforms, many top-rated podcasts, and really offering audiences a unique understanding of the power of the mind and how to become the most powerful version of yourself. This is huge. Everything begins in the mind. And if you're familiar with my three-pillar approach to optimize fertility, we talk a lot about mindset and how everything starts in the mind and really cascades down to our fertility, our reproductive organs, our sex hormones. Mallory, tell us a little bit about why our mindset is so important and really just our overall health, specifically then that hormonal messages we send to our reproductive system.
It all goes to the nervous system. We have our rest and digest nervous system, and then we also have our fight or flight. And most of us don't realize how often our bodies are in a state of fight or flight. Is your body going to be in baby-making mode if it's in fight or flight? Well, no, it's not. It needs to be in that rest and digest and that calm state for all of your organs to really be functioning optimally to make a baby. So the reason this connects to the mind is because 95 to 97% of why we do what we do every single day connects to our subconscious programming. That is all where our memories are stored, where our past traumas are stored, where our unconscious thinking is stored. You know, when you go to brush your teeth, you don't think about how to brush your teeth. Again, your body habitually is doing this. The subconscious mind operates the same way. So you and I, and anyone who's listening to this, are really operating from that subconscious programming more often than we realize. And the connection to our nervous system, if we have stress responses and old patterns and traumas and stuff that's stored in that part of our brain, what we're actually doing is we're shifting into fight or flight, because our conscious awareness and our conscious thinking isn't allowing us to really be in that state of being for, again, that baby-making mode.
Yeah, I mean, that baby-making mode, as Mallory is saying, is also called parasympathetic dominance. And there's two versions that a nervous system can be in. Either that parasympathetic dominance, which is baby-making mode, welcome baby mode, as I like to call it in my program, or sympathetic dominance, which is that fight or flight, or what I like to call it, no place for a baby mode. Oftentimes we don't even maybe realize we're in no place for a baby mode, because if we don't recognize those patterns of our subconscious behavior, we can be in that mode even if we're thinking, oh, I'm not stressed. We can actually still be in that no place for a baby mode. Is that right, Mallory?
Yeah, it is. And a lot of times this stuff is very unconscious. And I'll use myself as an example. Most of this stuff actually relates back to our childhood. So I grew up in a household that was not super stable. There was a lot of transition, a lot of changing, a lot of chaos. When I started growing into early adulthood, I started experiencing a lot of anxiety, a lot of stress, a lot of overwhelm. But it wasn't until I really looked at where the root of some of the stuff was coming from that I understood why my body was actually having the responses that it was having. I wasn't really stressed about traffic or the test that I needed to take in college or whatever it was. Yeah. It was all of this old trauma and old programming that was stuck in my memory bank that hadn't been healed, that was shifting my body into that fight or flight state on any given normal stress or thing that I was encountering. So it wasn't until I started really doing some deeper work around some of the old stuff that my state of being, your state of being like, what system are you really in? Are you in that parasympathetic? Are you in that sympathetic nervous system? That's when I really started to see shifts. And again, nobody's perfect. It's not that I don't ever get stressed out or things don't ever happen in my life that shift me into that fight or flight mode. This is not about perfection. This is just about looking deeper within and learning a little bit more about who we are so that we can really acknowledge, am I looking at my health journey from a lens of, all right, I just need to achieve this really quick and be done? Or am I holistically allowing myself to see who I'm becoming and addressing all the things on the checklist as well to achieve the outcome?
Amazing. I think that is huge. Even if we are doing the things now, you know, of course, in a functional fertility approach, we're working on nutrition and hormone balance and even our lifestyle and environment and how the changes in those areas can optimize our fertility. In my three-pillar approach, I start with pillar number one is the non-negotiables. And I work on something called stress mapping, and really kind of the idea, yes, there is going to be stress. We actually need stress to keep us alive. But the idea is to map that stress out so we understand where it's coming from and not let it sink in, but really kind of build like a little bulletproof vest, I like to call, and just let it roll off. We recognize it, we see it, but we let it roll off. And that I think is why it's a non-negotiable is because we really have to work on that before we even get into things like, all right, what foods are going to help support your specific fertility needs? What labs do we see that we need to improve and deficiencies? That mindset piece is non-negotiable number one. And this is where Mallory comes in and where her expertise just dives deeper into understanding how to go back and find why are we maybe stuck in that fight or flight mode or no place for a baby mode and maybe not even recognize it. So helping you to recognize it is number one. That's what Mallory dives into. And then helping you to find a way to address that and uncode that so that you're not carrying that with you through, you know, doing all the things, right? Like I get so many people that are doing all the things. They're eating really well and they're, you know, doing the right movement for their body and their environment is all cleaned up and they use clean products. But if that non-negotiable wasn't addressed, we're still stuck in that no place for a baby mode. So Mallory, how do you get people to begin that recognition and then begin to break that down with people?
Yeah. So it's really important for anybody, whoever you're working with, coaches wise, nutrition, anybody that's on your support team, because so many of us have a variety of people on our support teams. It's so important that we feel safe with them, right? Because if we don't feel safe with them, we're not going to allow ourselves to be vulnerable and open up and see the transformation and see the growth that can happen. So that first call with someone, those first like couple calls with people are so vital and so important. This does not come from a place of judgment. You know, I am not here to judge somebody for where they are in their life right now versus where they want to go. It's not about shaming. It's not about saying, oh, you're doing this completely wrong. You should be less stressed and maybe this will work, right? Like there's so many emotions that come up with desiring to bring a child into this world. There's so much identity that we wrap into this. It's really important to come from a place of love and compassion and understanding and meeting someone exactly where they're at right now with no judgment, no blame. And when we start looking at their background and their childhood, that also applies to that. This is not about judging our parents for what they did and didn't do. This isn't about judging our teachers and judging all the people and blaming people in our childhood for making us be a certain way. This is all about observation. When we observe, we can start to understand ourselves differently. When we witness the emotional trauma maybe that we've gone through that we have not witnessed and allowed ourselves to heal from, then we can move through it. So it's very, very important to come from a place of non-judgment, both with ourselves, but also with those mentors, those people that we're working with, to allow ourselves the space to heal through this stuff.
Amazing. Yeah, there's a quote that I love that it says, you're right where you need to be. And I love that. I think that's also what you're saying is even, you know, if we're in a tough spot, we can kind of be wondering, well, I'm not where I want to be, you know, like I don't want to be where I'm at. I hate where I'm at right now, but we are wherever you are at, you're where you need to be in order to do the work that needs to be done. And those people on your team can help you do that. I mean, I think so many people on a trying to conceive journey, they've heard this one statement that I'm about to say, and it just irks people. It's just stop stressing, right? Like, oh, stop stressing and you'll get pregnant, right? Like, oh, just go on vacation and get drunk, have sex, and then you're going to have a baby. That's such a loaded thing. And we've already talked why it's not that simple, right? We can be on vacation and feel relaxed in that moment. But again, we're kind of still bringing that, you know, that past into that present moment and still stuck in that no place for baby mode. And when you say just stop stressing, it kind of makes you stress more.
It does. And it's got a little bit of a shameful connotation to it. And the thing is, if we knew how to do that, we would have already been doing it, right? If our consciousness knew how to shift us in and out of that quickly, it would already be doing it. And part of this is acceptance of self and understanding, you know what? Maybe there is a little bit more work that I need to do. Maybe there is a little bit of growth that's available to me, but what a beautiful thing. It can be debilitating when you are not really sure how to heal your body and get better and do the things that you need to do to get yourself to that state. Well, I've worked with lots of women that really want a baby and they feel a lot of those similar emotions of like, why is this not happening? I really want this to happen and I feel like I'm doing all of the things to get there. That can be extremely challenging. And to really just look at all of this as a growth potential and a healing potential for the holistic picture, because a lot of times your growth ends up becoming your partner's growth too, and it brings you guys closer together. And there is this entire bubble that happens when you choose self-discovery. And just looking at this of not, okay, I'm gonna do this because it's going to get me to the baby. You're choosing this for you. You're choosing this because you're giving yourself the highest self-love that you possibly could. You're respecting yourself like you never have before, and you want to give yourself the opportunity to have an extremely fulfilled life experience. And maybe that does mean accepting and looking at some of the uglier things that have been avoided or the patterns that are, you know, being dismissed so that you can clean them up and move forward.
So many things there are so resonate with me, and I know they'll resonate with a lot of people listening to this. I recently actually changed my logo or slogan and Instagram handle my business. And it's for this exact reason. It's now Your Fertility, Your Future, because my goal for people is, yes, of course, I want you to get that positive pregnancy test. But the overall goal is for us to optimize your health now in that holistic or functional way so that your future, your baby's future, your partner's future is benefited. And so it really is starting with the now and bringing all that together to really give us that ultimate goal of a better self in the future. And, you know, whether that's with baby, without baby, and to just make sure that we're the happiest and healthiest possible. And ultimately, you know, our health is our baby's health, right? There's so many things that we pass down as the parents, both male partner and female partner. We actually set up the health of our baby into adulthood. Now studies are showing that the health of our adult children in the future is actually impacted by our health now when we conceive those children, and mindset, because that affects so many things from the, basically, you know, the head down, our gut health, our cortisol levels, our hormone production. What a huge gift that you could give to yourself right now, because you are right where you need to be, but then also that future family, no matter what that looks like, right?
Absolutely. And there's, you know, just in the health journey of making a baby, there's a lot of trauma that people experience through that. You know, I've worked with women that struggle with the feeling of that they've been trying and trying and trying, and it's been years, and why are all their friends having babies and why aren't they? And that comes up with that brings up a lot of identity work for people and a lot of healing opportunities for people to really look at that. And, you know, some people experience a lot of grief. They go through this process and they have miscarriages, and that is unprocessed yet still being carried onto the next thing. And then it creates this fear of continuing and doing the IVF again. And there's so much emotion wrapped up in this process. And it's so important to just witness it, not just shove it down, not pretend like it didn't happen, but also not get stuck in the fear that that emotion is permanent and that you can't heal from it. So there's just a lot that comes up on this journey.
Yeah. And so, and really working with someone individually that you trust to talk with and open up with, and that may not be me and that may not be Mallory.
If someone listens to this and it speaks to them and they have another person that's on their mind, allow this to open you up for whatever's next for you. This isn't about like, hey, get on the phone with me.
Exactly. It's really just bringing that awareness to this, you know, our bodies in two states, welcome baby, no place for baby mode. This is actually something I wanted to ask you, Mallory, like, So someone's listening to this and they're thinking, well, I don't really have a traumatic history, right? Like, I had a great childhood. And I would actually say that I'm this person. So I had a great childhood, wonderful family, no trauma. Mm-hmm. And so oftentimes when I heard this word trauma, I thought, well, that's not for me. And I immediately dismissed the idea of doing that inner work or like diving into maybe that I was and stuck in that stressful state, even though in the present I didn't feel it. I always thought, well, that's not for me. I don't need to do that. And for me, the big eye opener was actually doing the Dutch test that I do in my practice. It's a hormone test because it shows our hormones on a whole body level. It's not just looking at your sex hormones. It's looking at your stress hormones as well. And when I looked at that, it showed that my stress was completely unmanaged. I felt like I wasn't stressed in the moment. And I was like, these are not my results. Like, they must have got these messed up with someone else. Like, this is not me. I am not stressed out. My adrenals are healthy. And I even did like some mindfulness and some little things here and there. I dabbled. Mm-hmm. It really started off on this journey of me understanding that growing up in that happy, healthy family, I actually never processed anything because I wanted to be that happy person. You know what I mean? Yes. Exactly. So I was like putting up this, no, I'm fine. Everything's fine. I'm great. I'm happy. I'm Olivia. I'm always cheerful. Mm-hmm. That became my identity. And I went through, most of us do, just some things in my adulthood. I went through 2 failed engagements. The wedding was called off the day before. And I mean, but you asked, right. But in my mind, I just thought, no, you know, it's okay. You know, I'm good. It happened for a reason. I'm good. And then I realized, oh my gosh, yeah, I'm not even dealing with these things. And those things were traumatic and bam, like doors opened and hormone journey began and all this stuff. So for that person who doesn't think that they've had trauma, like what would you suggest? Or if they said, no, I don't need to talk to someone like Mallory, what would you say to that person?
Everybody's had trauma. I've never encountered someone that didn't have some type of trauma. And the thing about trauma is we need to remember that I think our association, because of what we saw on TV and how we see the word trauma all over the place now, we think that it's more volatile, abusive type of childhoods, but trauma's also the opposite. It's also rejection. You know, if you grew up in a family where your mom or dad were emotionally unavailable, what does that teach you as a child? Mm. Or like you're saying, I see that experience too a lot with people growing up in a family where emotions weren't necessarily super open. Well, what does that teach you? It teaches the body, not even just the mind, but it teaches the body that anger and grief and sadness and frustration, those are not safe places to go. So when you feel those things, you end up putting it in a box and setting it over here, and then eventually it's going to blow up, right? But we need to just remember that all of our experiences led to different ways that we believe and what we believe in now. And all of the things that we do go back to 2 things, what we believe about ourselves and what we believe about the world. If we don't know what we think about those 2 things, I guarantee you there's some work that you have the potential to do. I'm not saying, you know, everybody needs to do this or you're going to be doomed. That's not what I mean at all.
Yeah.
But you have the potential to open up some space and explore a little deeper into yourself to move forward and probably heal some things that you're not realizing maybe blocking you in different areas of your life.
Yeah, amazing. And when we aren't opening up to that, do you think the idea that as women who are the ones to, you know, carry a child in their womb, if we have that unprocessed trauma, we have this innate ability and a very powerful ability to kind of like stuff that all into our womb and just kind of suppress it. And we're filling that womb with these unprocessed emotions. There's really no place to grow a baby, right? And to bring on life. Is that something that you have come across?
Absolutely. And that really gets into masculine and feminine dynamics. A lot of us that are operating more from that trauma response without realizing it, both you and I have had previous trauma responses that we were operating from, both very different backgrounds and different stories. They're almost the opposite. If you really look at the trauma spectrum, you were maybe here and I was maybe here, but we both were operating from trauma places. Both of those things were putting us more in our masculine energy. And what I mean by that is the masculine energy is more of this like, go, 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 driven, drive, achievement, everything's okay, let's move to one thing to the next, because masculine energy is all about providing like security, right? Mm-hmm. That's what masculine energy does. So we have masculine and feminine often in our relationships, even with same gender relationships, we see it. Mm-hmm. And we have masculine and feminine within ourselves. Most women are very disconnected from our feminine nature because our backgrounds have not taught us that our feminine nature is a safe place to be. That feminine being, that more in connection with our emotions. And you know what? Being okay sometimes that you're going to do this in a day because you're a woman, and that just means that's who you are. It doesn't mean that you're overly emotional or weak or this or that. It just means that we feel a lot more than the male brain feels, right? And allowing that space to be safe, allowing space for rest. I mean, if you just think about your schedule and what we put on our schedules and the norm being like busy and overcommitted and filled and no space for really allowing ourselves to just be with ourselves. Dance, play, you know, the word play, I love asking people that question. Well, how much play do you let in your life? Often the answer is like, well, I don't really have time for that. Well, that's a huge indicator that you're stuck in your masculine energy because you have this big, vibrant, feminine energy inside of you that just wants to play and be colorful and be herself and express herself all the time. But are you allowing that to open up? So it absolutely goes completely in line with what you're saying. This is a huge, huge part of that womb energy, that feminine energy that just wants to open up and create space for a baby.
Amazing. And I think there's so many pressures in society today to know to be that on the go 24/7, productive, you know. And I work with so many women that are, you know, they own their own business, they're kick ass, they, you know, get shit done, they are on the ball 24/7 because that's the environment that they're in. And it is very hard to pull back and realize that play, that idea of play, Mallory, is, I think that's something that almost we think that we're doing something wrong if we have time to play or we have time to be creative. It's like, you know, I don't have time for that. It's such a, I think a lot of people kind of wear that as a badge of honor. Like, oh, I'm too busy to.
Diminishes the feminine. And we think, oh, that's not powerful enough. That's not going to help. I need to just keep following the checklist. Like, that's a very dominant masculine thing. No, Olivia, just tell me like how much water I need to drink and do I need to eat, what I need to eat? Like, just tell me those things.
Tell me what I need to do and I'll do it. That's what I hear. Yep. A lot. And it is, that seems like a simplistic way to do it. You know, it's just like a checklist, like any other thing, like that probably got them to where they are now in their careers, right? In their success. That's how
Exactly.
That's what they know. Mm-hmm. And many of us know, and that's how we operate. And just to think and step back, like Mallory said, and think, we all have this, the masculine and feminine energy. All of us have this. And for women to just think, hey, in a month's time, in 30 days' time, my hormones go through drastic changes, right? Like our cycles. And I actually, in my three-pillar approach, I have something that I created called the Ultimate Period Guide. And it is just educating women on what your body does in a month.
Right. That's so brilliant because I don't remember being in school having anybody tell me about the different cycles that I go through in my period. I thought it was just you bleed or you don't bleed, right? Like, and then you learn that, okay, on some of those phases, you're also ovulating. But there's so much more to it than that.
Exactly. I'm so unfortunate we don't know that, and we aren't taught that as young women to appreciate the changes that our body go through in the month. And honestly, it gives us a lot of creativity and insight that men never, a masculine energy or men, because they don't, you know, ovulate and go have a menstrual cycle, that they can't access. If we are able to actually honor that and know that and understand it and respect it, our ability as a cycling woman to break into those little superpowers, I call them, is really incredible. But we oftentimes don't even acknowledge they're there because we're just a steady, we want to be, you know, consistently productive, consistently on it, consistently, you know, fill in the blank. But we are these cyclic creatures.
I know there's a lot going on in the world right now, but I think it's such a brilliant time to be alive because it makes me wonder how these tiny little babies that are brought into this world, how they're going to grow up. Because I feel like they're going to be exposed with so many different tools and education on things that you and I didn't learn growing up. And it just makes me wonder what the generations after that, how they're going to be as adults. You know, it's just a really interesting time to be witnessing how conscious everyone is choosing to mm-hmm. become and the awareness that's shifting on the planet.
What a hopeful sentiment to bring this to a close on. That is just bringing us back to as well, that your fertility, your future, right? Understanding by being conscious of where you are now, understanding the difference of that fight or flight versus rest and digest or no place for a baby mode versus welcome baby mode. And really understanding that it's more than a checklist to go through in the day and diving in and doing that work. Even if this conversation just gets you to think about, did I have trauma, or an understanding the difference of one trauma versus another trauma, that trauma is just a very collective word for a lot of different experiences, and understanding that we can do a lot to change our health now to really change our future in any way that we want. Thank you for your time, Mallory. And is there anything that you want to kind of end on?
If you ask yourself the question, what do I believe about myself? And you also ask yourself the question, what do I believe about the world? And you don't have any answers. All that means is it's not a bad thing. All that means is there's opportunity to do some deeper work because you don't know, right? And why not figure it out?
Yeah. I love that. I'm going to work on that myself today. So thank you, Mallory. I so appreciate your time and your expertise. And hopefully we could do this again soon.